Hi everybody, this is Seth Isaacson for Rock Island Auction Company, here today to talk to you about number 30 through 21 on our top 50 list for our May 14th through 16th Premier Firearms Auction. Starting with number 30, we've got a beautiful cased pair of Colt 1860 Army revolvers. It wouldn't be a Rock Island Auction Company Premier sale without a bunch of immaculate Colt percussion revolvers. This pair certainly fits that bill. If you take a look at them, they're silver plated, engraved, they got the late percussion vine scroll engraving. They've got really nice relief carved Mexican Eagle grips. And if you actually look on the second gun of the pair, it's on the opposite side. So one's on the right grip, one's on the left side. So if you had this pair and holsters on your belt, you'd have, you know, one grip on your right side, one grip on your left side, and the carving would be faced out on both sides. That's one of the ways you can tell this is made as a true pair, because they're made, you know, matching engraving, carving on opposite sides. They're also only 5 serial numbers apart, and they're manufactured in 1865. With the Mexican style grip on this, this would be a perfect, you know, presentation pair to say a Mexican military or political leader in the restored Republic of the late 1860s in Mexico after the French intervention was defeated. And if you look at the case inside, you know, it's got a really nice set of accessories. You've got a nice silver plated Colt patent flask. You've got the dual caliber bullet mold. You got two cap tins, little turned container, some bullets, key, everything you'd need. So this beautiful pair is number 30 on our top 50 list. For number 29 on our list, we've got two Colt Model 1900 Sight Safety semi-automatic pistols. Both of these are really significant, so we kind of lumped these two together and kind of cheated a little bit. So the one on my left is serial number 86, obviously very early in production. And the one on my right here is US Navy contract number 138 of 250 made. Both of these pistols remain in the original sight safety configuration. If I pick the one up on my left here, we'll pull the camera back so it's out of the way so you guys can see a little better. The rear sight actually doubles as the safety mechanism. So if you push that down, it now blocks the firing pin and the gun is in safe. Flip it back up, it's ready to go. So obviously with a little easy switch like this, and that's the sole safety on this gun, that's pretty easy to bump up and down. So it was determined to be a weak spot, so only the first 3,000 of these had these sight safeties, and many of them were later converted and had these removed. So to have two of them, both historic guns, both with the original sight safety in one sale, is quite remarkable. One of the other remarkable things about these two pistols is both of them remain in really high condition, especially when you consider the gun on the right. This is a U.S. government contract pistol, and it's got, you know, the really nice early Colt high polish blue finish. So for number 29 on our list, we've got two Colt Model 1900 Sight Safety semi-automatic pistols. Number 28 on our list is three Tiffany decorated Smith & Wesson double action revolvers. Only a very small number of these revolvers were made in the 1880s to early 1900s. Many of them were displayed at the World's Fairs, including the one here in the middle. It was displayed at the 1893 World's Columbian Exposition in Chicago. So each of these guns was decorated by Tiffany & Company of New York. You can see they're all like a very elaborate Art Nouveau kind of style. Each one is a very individualized piece. They're decorated with, you know, very interesting grips. They've got acid etching on the barrels. This one's got a very, you know, unique for this series, you know, antique ivory grip built into the silver grip that they've installed on the gun. There's only a small number of these exist. All three of these are from the Dr. Gerald Klaas collection. By far, Dr. Gerald Klaas had the most of these revolvers. Many of the ones you can see in the Met today were donated by Dr. Gerald Klaas, and these three are directly out of his collection. So number 28 on our list is three Smith & Wesson Tiffany decorated double action revolvers. For number 27 on our list, we have two of the over 120 lots of Class 3 items in the sale. So the one on my right is an H&K G3. This one has a registered auto sear. So beyond the fact that this is currently configured as a machine gun, legally, the auto sear is what is the machine gun per the federal government. So you could take that auto sear and install it into another compatible firearm. So that's obviously a very versatile lot in terms of the way it's set up and the way it's registered. And beyond that, I mean, the G3 is obviously also a classic assault rifle and very desirable in and of its own right. And then on my left, we've got a Colt M16A1. This is the classic American assault rifle of the late 1960s to early 1980s. Now, this is one of those guns that just about every AR-15 collector would die to have. There's obviously a very limited number that are registered and available. So for number 27 on our list, we have two of the over 120 Class 3 items in the sale. Number 26 from our list is a pair of Royal Presentation Grade flintlock holster pistols by Franco Bigoni of Brescia. So from a distance, both of these pistols may look like they're exact matches. And they're clearly made as a pair, but if you get into the finer details, each one of the details on these guns is different. You know, the carving and stuff is very similar, but if you get into the individual scenes and all these different silver panels, even the smaller details in the locks, all those details are similar but different in each gun, representing different scenes from Greco-Roman mythology. And then one of the very interesting aspects of these pistols is back here on the escutcheon plates. So if you look at the escutcheon on this pistol, you'll see it's a male figure underneath the crown of the King of the Romans. And then if you look on the second pistol, you've got the same crown on top of a different portrait, this time of a woman. So that's significant. These pistols are from around 1740. In that period, Maria Theresa and Francis I were married, but they were not yet Holy Roman Emperor and Empress. And each of those portraits on the escutcheon plates are rather similar to their 1736 marriage medallion from their wedding. So with them being the figures most likely on the escutcheon plates, obviously they're the ones that are most fitting given the time period, it's very likely that these pistols may have been presented to a nobleman within the Holy Roman Empire, possibly by the Emperor or Empress themselves, possibly to the Emperor or Empress themselves. And one of the other things that's really special about these guns, if you take a really close look again, is you'll note there's a screw here for the frizzen, completely normal. There's a screw in the barrel tangs to secure the barrels, but the rest of the guns are completely constructed without any visible fasteners, which is very unusual. That would be very difficult to execute. Definitely something if you were a gun maker and you were trying to show off to the Emperor or the Empress, to maybe to establish yourself as the royal gun maker, the kind of thing you'd want to do. So number 26 on our list is a pair of beautiful flintlock pistols from Brescia in northern Italy. For number 25 on our list, we've got another selection from the John Fox Collection, a celebration of the American West. Each one of these guns is obviously an individual piece of American history in and of itself. I want to go through them one at a time real quickly. So both of the two Winchester Model 1876s on my left are tied to the Old West. Both of them are 5095 Express. The one in the front is attributed to the Marquis de Moore. He was a French nobleman that moved to the Dakota Territories, established himself as a rancher. The town of Medora is named after his wife. One of his neighbors there was a young Theodore Roosevelt, who was also ranching in the area. The two were sometimes friends, sometimes rivals. They both tried to join the Stuart Stranglers. Both were denied because of their high profile names. And one of the things that's significant about this rifle is DeMore was involved in a shooting in which a man was killed. A group of men essentially came into Medora and were firing their guns in the air, insulting the Marquis, basically trying to egg him on. He sent in the local deputy, said, if you know you don't complete the arrest, we'll assume you've been killed and assume we're deputized, and basically we'll handle things from there. As the men did flee arrest, they tried to flee town, and he shot one of the men. Because of that, he was, you know, basically investigated and ultimately tried for murder. And while he was in jail in 1885, he had men that were supposedly paying witnesses to speak against him, and he thought that possibly Theodore Roosevelt, who he had quarreled with over land and cattle issues, may have been involved. So he wrote to Roosevelt saying, I thought you were my friend. If you are my enemy, I want to know it. I am always on hand, as you know, and between gentlemen, it is easy to settle matters of that sort directly. Now, the words directly certainly implies that he had no qualms dueling our future president. And Roosevelt responded, most emphatically, I am not your enemy. If I were, you would know it. For I would be an open one and would not have asked you to my house nor gone to yours. As your final words, however, seem to imply a threat, it is due to myself to say that the statement is not made through any fear of possible consequences to me. I too, as you know, am always on hand and ever ready to hold myself accountable in any way for anything I have said or done. That settled the issue. They did not ultimately duel. But before the issue was settled, Roosevelt had made a comment to one of his friends that if he was challenged, he would choose Winchester rifles at 12 paces. So theoretically, had they ended up dueling, our future president could have very well been shot at by this rifle. The 50 Express 76 here at the back, if you look carefully on the front, it is inscribed W.S. Negus, 1880. And this rifle was one of the three rifles ordered by Granville Stuart with his famous Boss Game Gun of all creation that we sold in our last sale. W.S. Negus was one of the most wealthy ranchers, businessmen in the region in the time period, one of Granville Stuart's counterparts. This gun's got honest signs of use. It's been well maintained, but you know, the finish is worn, but the metal is in great condition. The markings all remain crisp. The wood's still in really nice shape. I mean, a beautiful has been there, was there, Winchester 1876 from the Old West. Then on my right-hand side, we've got, again, more guns from the John Fox collection. This is a very large collection, a really impressive collection accumulated over an entire lifetime of collecting. Large percentage of these guns came out of the Montana area or out of the Dakotas. Revolver at the front is probably the oddball out of the group, but a very fine, very interesting Colt revolver from the period, manufactured just after the Civil War. And unlike the rest of them, which are all tied very strongly to, you know, the Dakotas, the Montana Territory, that part of the country, this one's got a golden eagle eating a snake perched on a cactus based on the coat of arms of Mexico. So a revolver like this would have been an excellent presentation piece to, say, a Mexican officer or politician from the restored republic after the French were kicked out of Mexico in the 1860s. So the next one we've got is just a classic model 1874 shipped to the Montana Territory in 4570, just a classic Old West sporting rifle. And then to the back, we've got something a little more unusual. This is arguably the finest Sharps rifle in existence that was shipped to Walter Cooper in Montana. But it's not an 1874. If you look carefully, this was actually a new model rifle that was converted Meacham style to be a cartridge rifle. You can still see there's a cutout here on the frame for where the original percussion hammer would have came down. And if I cock the hammer back, you can see a little piece of metal filled in there from the earlier priming system. And like I said before, this is arguably the finest Walter Cooper Sharps we've in existence. If you look at the blue on the barrel, it's nice and bright. There's still nice case colors on the frame. Just a fantastic rifle overall. So for number 25 on our list, we've got a selection of arms from the John Fox collection. All right, number 24 on our list is one of the finest, earliest U.S. military contract model 1911 semi-automatic pistols. This pistol is serial number 151. It was manufactured in the first full month of production and was assembled on January 25th of 1912. It was shipped to the commanding officer of Springfield Armory on February 3rd, 1912, in a shipment of 200 pistols. So this is one of the absolute earliest Colt model 1911 semi-automatic pistols. You know, one of the, if not the, most popular, most famous American sidearms in history, you know, probably closely linked with maybe the Colt Single Action Army. With very little changes, you know, the 1911 served the US military all the way from World War I into the War on Terror. But as you can see, this pistol, while it may have seen some use, remains in really high condition. It still retains the bright, original, high polish blue finish that Colt used only on the early military contract pistols. You know, the later ones will have the more dull blue military finish. Not this one, it's got the bright, vibrant colors of the early Colt semi-autos. If you look down here, you've got the early serial number, you got model of 1911 US Army. And then when I flip it over here, you can see it's got the early inspector's mark. You got the nice checkered walnut grips. I mean, just an absolute classic, iconic 1911 in really high condition from very, very early in production. Number 24 on our list is serial number 151 US contract Colt model 1911 semi-automatic pistol. For number 23 on our list, we have a selection of Civil War artifacts all tied to officers in the Union Army. So the sword at the back to my right here, this was presented after the Mexican-American War to George McClellan, the future General-in-Chief of the Union Armies during the Civil War. He is one of only four men to hold that title. So if you look at the inscription here on the scabbard, it reads, presented to Lieutenant George B. McClellan of the Corps of Sappers and Miners, USA, by a number of gentlemen as a testimonial of their high admiration for his gallantry during the war with Mexico, first at the Siege of Veracruz, second at the Battle of Cerro Gordo, third at the Battle of Contreras, fourth at the Battle of Churubusco, fifth Chapultepec, sixth capture of the City of Mexico. So this sword is one of nine swords that were presented to McClellan that were given to the Smithsonian Institution by George McClellan Jr. in 1917. We know it was on display there based on period news articles. We don't know exactly when it left the Smithsonian collection. So with George McClellan being the General-in-Chief of the Union Armies, the next piece in this set that makes the most sense to cut to is this historic commission of Ulysses S. Grant as Major General of Volunteers from 1862. So early in the Civil War, Ulysses S. Grant was something of an unknown figure, But on February 6, 1862, the Union forces captured Fort Henry, a Confederate fortification in Donelson, Tennessee. Grant was supposed to be there, but it actually fell to the Union gunboats first. So instead, Grant, who was leading the Union troops on the ground, informed General Halleck that he was moving on to take Fort Donelson immediately. Most of the Confederate troops that had fled Fort Henry had consolidated at Fort Donelson, the more formidable fort in the region. And from February 11th to February 16th, Grant's forces laid siege on Fort Donelson near the Tennessee-Kentucky border. And on the 15th, the Confederate commander, Brigadier General Simon Buckner, sent a note to Grant requesting terms of surrender. Grant refused the conditional surrender terms set by his adversarial counterpart and instead famously demanded no terms except an unconditional and immediate surrender can be accepted. And the fort fell the next day. Due to his initials and refusing the terms of surrender, Grant became known as Unconditional Surrender Grant. This commission is arguably one of, if not the most significant Civil War commissions that remains in private hands. Most of Grant's other commissions, you know, are institutionalized and completely out of access for collectors. So this commission was retained by the family for many years for obvious reasons. You know, this is his big promotion at the beginning of the war, kind of rose him to national prominence. Eventually, President Lincoln famously put him in charge as General-in-Chief of the Union Army, specifically because tactics like he used at Fort Donelson, where he threw caution to the wind and charged right in and got the job done. Lincoln was famously, you know, frustrated with his other generals because they were too timid, too cautious, whereas Grant charged in and secured victory for the Union. And the last two items in this group, also historic, both presented to Colonel Jacob G. Frick, a Medal of Honor winner. The inscription here on the sword reads, presented to Lieutenant Colonel J.G. Frick, 96th Regiment, PV, by his friends in the regiment for his gallant conduct at Gaines Hill, June 27th, and his efficiency as an officer, July 1862. Jacob Frick was a 3rd Lieutenant in the 3rd Ohio Infantry during the Mexican-American War, and later 2nd Lieutenant in the 11th U.S. Infantry. In the Civil War, he first served as a Lieutenant Colonel and the 2nd in command of the 96th Pennsylvania Volunteer Infantry. On July 29, 1862, Frick resigned from the 96th in order to become the Colonel and Commander of the new 129th Pennsylvania Volunteer Infantry, and led that unit at the Battle of Fredericksburg and the Battle of Chancellorsville, where his actions earned him the Medal of Honor. And then the walking stick at the front has a nice inscribed gold handle. This was presented to Frick after the Civil War in 1873 while he was a U.S. government tax collector in Pottsville, Pennsylvania. So number 23 in our list is a group of historic Civil War era artifacts, each linked to Union officers from the Civil War. Number 22 on our list is an absolutely stunning, previously unpublished Winchester Model 1866 lever-action carbine engraved by none other than Gustav Jung. This gun was very likely exhibited as part of Winchester's 200-gun display at the historic Philadelphia Centennial International Exhibition in 1876. And Gustav Jung handled very small amount of work for Winchester, but it's some of his absolute finest work. One of Jung's greatest masterpieces is a Winchester 1873 serial number 16139, which actually states in the records that it was engraved by Jung. And this rifle was the centerpiece of Winchester's display at the 1876 exposition, which we believe was alongside this carbine. So as you can see on the carbine itself, I mean, it's in really, really high condition. It's got, you know, really nice, lightly frosted nickel plating showing age, but really well maintained. And if you get into the details of the engraving and you look at the style of the scrollwork with the punch dot backgrounds, you look at the scenes, you look at the details overall, I mean, they're all characteristic of Jung's work. I mean, look at the borders along the edges of the frame. And on the left side, you can see there's a nice panel scene of a dog, which, you know, dog heads were commonly featured on some of the engraved Colt percussion revolvers done by Jung. Of course, you have the classic wolf head motif or dog head motif you put on a lot of the hammers on the Colts. So it's very, again, fitting with his style. Then if you look at the stock and the form on this gun, again, highly figured walnut with a really nice finish, very clean, very high condition overall, an absolutely stunning carbine. Easily one of the finest Winchester 1866 I've seen in a very long time. So number 22 on our list is a historic, previously unpublished Winchester 1866 engraved by none other than Gustav Jung. Number 21 on our list is a 1923 experimental prototype Thompson submachine gun. This particular model 1921 Thompson is documented as a 21 LB for long barrel. It was shipped to the Hercules Powder Company of New Jersey in June of 1923 and is chambered for .45 Remington Thompson. The Remington Thompson cartridge is kind of similar to a .357 Magnum in that it's a longer, more powerful cartridge designed to not fit in an unsuitable weapon. And it's designed specifically to get the maximum firepower out of the longer barrel on one of these Thompsons. But this is an absolutely exceptionally fine Thompson submachine gun, incredibly rare as a prototype. And if you look at it, it's got the, you know, all the things that a Thompson submachine gun was known for. You know, a lot of later machine guns are a little more utilitarian. A Thompson is finished very fine. You can see it's got a beautiful blue finish. It's got nice oil-finished wood. Just a beautiful, iconic, you know, Prohibition-era Thompson submachine gun. Number 21 on our list.